try to ask everybody to speak up a little bit. My name is Carly Watson. I'm the program and events coordinator for the debate team, and I'll be moderating the debate today. Tonight's debate is going to be about surveillance and about false data collection, and it's a topic that has a connection to this date in particular, September 11th. And many of the controversies that we're going to be talking about today are really an outgrowth of the United States' reaction to the terror attacks of 9/11. And we think it's important to have a conversation about all of the different policy aspects that are associated with those decisions. But we also kind of want to keep in mind the real human tragedy that occurred on this day 16 years ago. And so if you would just please join me in a moment of silence to take a moment and reflect and remember and honor those that lost their lives on September 11th. We wanted to have this debate today to look at where the United States is 16 years later in its counterterrorism response. In October of 2001, just a month after this 9/11 attacks, and in response to those in the anthrax attacks, the United States Congress passed what was known as the Patriot Act. It authorized an expansion of presidential powers in order to fight terrorism. And opponents have criticized the authorization of indefinite detention, the relaxed standards for law enforcement searches, and the expanded surveillance that came about as a result of the Patriot Act. Although there's been ebbs and flows in the authority granted by the Patriot Act over the last 16 years, opponents still maintain that the United States has continued bulk data collection and surveillance without any meaningful restraints. And that's what we're going to be debating about today, bulk data collection and its contribution to counterterrorism. So I'm going to explain just a little bit about the format and the sides. We have students from the MSU debate team today participating in the debate. Lena Grossman, a sophomore at James Madison, and Jack Mueller, a freshman physics major, are going to be arguing today that bulk data collection ought to be ended. And Lauren Pepper, a zoology sophomore, and Evan Jones, a freshman at James Madison, are going to be arguing that continuing bulk data collection is necessary for the United States' counterterrorism efforts. Just a few notes about formats that you all know. Each student is going to begin with an opening speech that lasts about 5 minutes. I'll be giving them time cues from kind of over in the corner. We're going to start with Jack today. And at the conclusion of each opening speech, the opposing team is going to have an opportunity for what we call cross-examination, which is just a fancy opportunity for them to do a question-answer period. After all four students have given their opening speeches, we'll have an opportunity for the audience to do a cross-examination. So if you all have questions throughout the first couple of speeches, note them, remember them, and then during the audience cross-examination period, you'll have a chance to ask the students what you've been thinking about over the course of the debate. And then at the conclusion of those, and at the conclusion of the audience cross-examination, we're going to have a concluding remarks from each side, which we call a rebuttal in a debate, a time for them to give their closing statement. Just one thing that's important to remember is that the students have been asked today to research and defend a side that they don't even necessarily believe in. They've worked over the last couple of months to do research, learn about the topic, and defend a side that was assigned to them. So you might ask them questions and they might answer, but it might not even be necessarily the thing that is their personally held belief. But we think that's important to kind of being able to represent both sides of an argument. So that's a lot of information about just kind of what's going to happen. You all see it take place, and we're going to start off with a speech from Jack.
Now, before this debate started, were you using your cell phone? Were you checking Facebook, your bank account, your Twitter, your Snapchat? Did you make a call on your way to the MSU Union today? Well, your activity was logged, and it's what comprises metadata. Now, metadata is data that describes other data. In other words, the National Security Agency, or NSA, isn't listening necessarily to the content of your phone calls, but they can see who you called, how often you called them, and how long your calls lasted. Now, even GPS locations from your phone are stored and analyzed by the government. This is called bulk data surveillance because of the vast information collected in the process. And it was originally authorized by the Patriot Act in response to the September 11th terrorist attacks. The NSA argued that they needed to create a web of personal connections for a suspected terrorist in order to investigate and stop a potential attack. But Edward Snowden shocked the world in 2013 when he revealed that government surveillance covered credit card transactions, phone records, Facebook data, GPS locations, and included spying on foreign nations that the U.S. considered to be allies. There have been attempts to curb the power of metadata surveillance since the Snowden leaks, but the practice largely continues undebated. Today, our side will argue that the concerns about privacy and foreign relations are reasons that the United States should cease bulk data collection. Our opponents will surely engage in fear-mongering over the threat that terrorism necessitates, but I want to foreground the conversation by saying that an independent agency created by Congress studied reports about how the metadata surveillance program had been used, and the board found no instances in which it had stopped the terrorist attack. My partner will be getting a bit into more about the details of the intersection between metadata and terrorism. So I would like to talk about the main reasons why the United States should cease bulk data collection. First and foremost, privacy. The right to privacy ought to be considered foundational for American democracy. The Supreme Court has ruled that the Constitution implicitly grants the right to privacy against governmental intrusion from the First, Third, Fourth, and Fifth Amendments. Daniel Sullivan, assistant professor at George Washington University Law School, explains the importance of protecting privacy. Quote, "Surveillance can create chilling effects on free speech, free association, and other First Amendment rights essential for a democracy. Now, chilling effects harm society because they reduce the range of viewpoints expressed and the degree of freedom with which to engage in political activity, which is a blatant violation of our liberty. Some might think that they have nothing to hide, so there is nothing to be lost in giving away their privacy. However, Sullivan warns, aggregation means that by combining pieces of information we might not care to conceal about at first, the government can glean information that we really do want to conceal. Data mining is able to reveal a lot about our personalities and activities by sophisticated means of analyzing data. It is hard to claim that the NSA will not reveal information people do not want to hide, as we do not know precisely what is revealed from the bulk data collection. And while you might not now be concerned about privacy, that privacy is important in the abstract, you still might find yourself persuaded that the threat of terrorism justifies NSA surveillance. But security threats are used as a trump card over the interests of civil liberties. And this means that some of the most legally questionable modern practices have been born from the threat of terrorism. Yet this is still a harm worth addressing, even if it's not sensationalistic, because the potential to intrude upon our First Amendment liberties is so great. I would now like to turn to the second reason that we believe bulk data collection should end: foreign relations. As a USIT think tank cautions that U.S. surveillance has justified foreign protectionism as countries erect barriers to cloud computing and cross-border data flows. Amid growing anti-U.S. sentiment, the European Union has seen calls for data localization, trying to keep as much data within Europe as possible. There's been a trend of countries passing laws that prevent citizens' personal information from leaving the country's borders, which has strong implications for the economy. Laura Donahue, professor of Georgetown Law, explains the implications of data localization. U.S. companies have lost revenues as countries concerned about U.S. surveillance efforts have accelerated data localization initiatives and introduced new privacy protections that have had implications for U.S. economic growth. It could be argued data localization initiatives are merely opportunistic, using the NSA revelations to advance national interests ahead of ours. The NSA programs do provide countries with an opportunity, regardless of whether the countries are being opportunistic or not, and they have weakened the U.S. hand in the international arena. When foreign allies don't trust the United States, it imperils the free exchange of ideas and trade, but it also risks cooperation on broader mutual goals. The Snowden leaks about foreign spying seriously jeopardized the U.S. relationship with Europe, and bulk data collection further risks foreign relations by causing data localization. While our opponent will no doubt provide a credible defense of bulk data collection to fight terrorism, I would urge you to remember the threats it poses to privacy and foreign relations. Thank you so much. You began with a list of activities that people were engaged in before they got to this debate. Many of those people also probably knew about NSA surveillance. Do you think that those people changed their behavior because of NSA surveillance?
I think regardless of whether these specific people changed their behavior with regards to NSA surveillance, I do think that the potential for them to change their behavior is in and of itself a threat to democracy. And I think that we should consider that.
But isn't that your argument about privacy, that people will be forced to change their behavior when they would otherwise engage in already legal activities?
Yes, well, for all we know, the people who in the audience today probably have changed their behavior consciously or subconsciously. And in fact, I would argue that the bulk data collection initiatives have already threatened our privacy and our First Amendment freedoms in this way.
So are people, across the United States as a whole, are people speaking out less about their beliefs?
I would say that across the United States as a whole, while we do not have any direct evidence for this, the potential for this to happen is present, and I would argue that enough is a threat.
You stated in your speech that the Snowden leaks caused international backlash. Presumably that was largely because it leaked that the United States was spying on foreign allies. But even though those leaks happened in 2013, why didn't that end counterterrorism cooperation?
I feel, although it didn't necessarily end counterterrorism cooperation, what it did do was cause a massive strain on foreign relations. And this, as I explained, is observable within the data localization initiatives that the countries, that European countries did.
Okay. President Trump has withdrawn the United States from negotiations over free trade agreements with European allies. Would that not imperil counterterrorism cooperation as well?
Well, I would say that the bulk data collection has already imperiled foreign relations to the point where any politician who makes the foreign arena more tumultuous has the potential to accelerate the harmful effects that bulk data collection has on.
Thank you. I have no further questions.
In 2015, terrorist attacks occurred in 100 countries, nearly double the countries seeing attacks in 2013, according to the University of Maryland's Global Terrorism Database. 16 years after the 9/11 attacks, when President Bush declared that his war on terror would not end until every terrorist group of global reach has been found, stopped, and defeated, the threat of terrorism is on the rise. In the face of that, our opponents would abandon a crucial counterterrorism strategy, bulk data collection. Today, I will begin by discussing the threat of terrorism from abandoning metadata collection, and then turn to address the privacy concerns raised by our opponents. First, the importance of bulk data collection fighting terrorism. I would like to begin with some explanation from James Lewis, a senior fellow at CSIS. If the risk of attack is increasing, it is not the right time to change the measures the United States has put in place to deter another 9/11. We are left with conflicting opinions of intelligence officials and civil libertarians as to what makes effective counter-terror programs. Interviews with current and former intelligence officials give us some guidance. the consensus among those individuals is that bulk data collection is useful. Ending bulk data collection would not come without some increase in risk. Our opponents are correct when they say that tracking and preventing a terrorist attack is exceptionally difficult. That is precisely why metadata is so important. The NSA should have access to every possible tactic in order to combat an elusive and rapidly changing enemy. Teresa Shea, Director of Signals Intelligence at the NSA, clarifies the importance. One of the greatest challenges in preventing catastrophic terrorist attacks on our country is identifying terrorist networks, particularly those within the US, and preventing threats by exploiting communications. It is imperative that we have the capability to rapidly detect any terrorist threat inside the US. One method the NSA has developed to accomplish this is analysis of metadata associated with telephone calls within, to, or from the US. By analyzing metadata based on telephone numbers associated with terrorist activity, trained expert intelligence analysts work to determine whether known or suspected terrorists have been in contact with individuals in the US. Foreign terrorist organizations use the telephone system to communicate, including calls to and from the US. Detecting types of communications was identified as a critical intelligence gap in the aftermath of the September 11th attacks. Metadata would have included the missing information and might have permitted NSA intelligence analysts to tip the FBI to the fact that the hijacker was calling the Yemeni safe house from a US location. The utility of metadata has long been recognized. Metadata produces information pertinent to counter-terror investigations and can contribute to the prevention of terror attacks. Independently, some scholars, like Samuel Raskoff, professor at NYU Law School, argue that the mere existence of metadata collection serves as a deterrent to terrorist attacks. It may convince networks that attacks must stay small in order to evade detection, or convince them to avoid attacks in the US altogether. Now, I would like to address the main benefit our opponents listed for ceasing bulk data collection, privacy. Of course, we would agree that privacy is an important tenet of American democracy. However, the issue that we are asked to address is far more complex than that. Concerns about privacy need to be balanced against the threat of terrorism. Neither one can be addressed in a vacuum. Shannon McDonough, instructor at Allen University, studied archival sources, government documents, and media reports to examine the claims made about the threat to privacy. She explains. Civil liberties organizations have routinely criticized post-9/11 counterterrorism initiatives as major threats to privacy. Our analysis reveals that a sizable number of claims raised against counterterror practices are without objective foundation in terms of any actual violations. As various data show, there is a fear of counterterrorism rather than of terrorism. These sensitivities bring about an increase in allegations of violations. McDonough's research suggests that there is a counter bias that fears the threats to privacy. Our opponents have suggested that our arguments about terrorism are fear-mongering, exaggerated threats to stoke concern. We would suggest, however, that perhaps our opponents' arguments fall into that category. Privacy is not an absolute right and must be balanced against security threats. That is the nuanced puzzle that we are asked to solve today. And, as I demonstrated, the threat of terrorism is too great in this instance to recklessly select privacy as a trump card. Thank you.
Yes, I'd like to begin with a question about the statistics you used to demonstrate that terrorism was on the rise. Now, the information from the Global Terrorism Index has been criticized by Daniel Biden, an expert at Georgetown University, for being somewhat misleading. How can you say that terrorist attacks are on the rise when they have recently started to include attacks that could have possibly been labeled as conflicts in a civil war?
Well, the fact that these attacks have a new label is exactly the point. They're a new type of attack. Our data includes attacks that might occur during a civil war, but have more far-reaching motivations or consequences, and thus can be categorized as terrorism. These are important inclusions when analyzing global trends. Your data's exclusion of them is proof that your analysis is biased towards privacy and away from the truth of security threats. Additionally, I'd argue that our source is more qualified. The Global Terrorism Index includes input from multiple experts, not just one.
Okay, thank you. Now, you have claimed that using sources from within the NSA federal government, that metadata collection is necessary, but considering how it hasn't actually directly stopped terrorist attack, do you have any evidence that it works?
You don't know that it hasn't stopped a terrorist attack. The NSA does not release highly classified information about terrorist networks to the public. I think that we should trust the people who have the security clearance to actually decide whether or not metadata has stopped major terrorist attacks.
Thank you. Speaking of discussing people with a clearance to investigate terrorism, aren't wiretaps and other intelligence agencies, other than the NSA, enough to curb the threat of terrorism?
I'd say that wiretaps are important, but targeted surveillance is useless without bulk data laying the foundation. In order for targeted surveillance to be effective, we need metadata to analyze communication trends and discover who is a potential target. Otherwise, we're just like randomly getting warrants to wiretap people and hoping that we stumble upon a terrorist.
Okay, thank you. Now, you have said that the war on terror hasn't even been won, even with the Patriot Act. When will the war on terror be won, if at any time, and how long will bulk data collection need to continue for the war on terror?
Right. We're not taking a stance on like the existence of the war on terror. We're saying that the fact that there has not been a major attack on U.S. soil since 9/11 is indicative of the fact that metadata surveillance works to deter those attacks on U.S. soil.
Our opponents have spent the majority of their opening speech discussing terrorism. But remember the statistic that my partner mentioned in the opening speech. The Congressional Board found no instances that bulk data collection stopped a terrorist attack. David Medin, the board chairman, stated that on a number of metrics, including thwarting plots and identifying terrorist activity, the program had not proven to be successful. Metadata collection is about more than simply finding a needle in a haystack. There are hundreds of millions of data points collected, and the aggregate of that information is used to try to discern a pattern. The Boston Marathon bombing displays that the NSA methodology is far from perfect. The brothers who carried out the bombings had previously been interviewed by the FBI and had made threats on Twitter, but the NSA's big data strategy had yet to detect a pattern in their metadata that would suggest they were a threat. Ray Corrigan, senior lecturer in mathematics, computing, and technology, explains the futility of the program. You cannot fix terrorism by treating the entire population as suspects and then engaging in suspicionless blanket collection and processing of personal data. Surveillance of the entire population, the vast majority of whom are innocent, leads to the diversion of limited intelligence resources in the pursuit of huge numbers of false leads. It is statistically impossible for total population surveillance to be an effective tool for catching terrorists. Even if your magic terrorist catching machine has a false positive rate of 1 in 1,000, it would flag 60,000 innocent people. Law enforcement need to be using modern digital technologies through targeted data preservation, not a mass surveillance regime, to engage in court-supervised surveillance of individuals whom they have reasonable cause to suspect. That is not the same as building an infrastructure of mass surveillance. Mass surveillance makes security services more difficult and the rest of us less secure. That brings me to my next point. More than just not helping to fight terrorism, I will argue that metadata collection is counterproductive as a strategy. First, metadata causes information overload. The unbelievable number of false positives causes law enforcement to use precious time and resources to track down constant dead ends. The error rate of a system that produces hundreds of millions of data points is overwhelming. Former NSA employees have described the task as similar to drinking from a fire hose. And the analytical capabilities of intelligence agencies have not kept up with the speed that information is accumulating. Additionally, each attack is unique. Who would have guessed that two pressure cooker bombs would be delivered to the Boston Marathon finish line in backpacks. Each individual attack can contain so much variability that detection using metadata is impossible. The same patterns that would flag a mass shooter would not catch terrorists that use vehicles at crowded events. The money and time that we're wasting on ineffective surveillance programs is not being spent on investigation, intelligence, and emergency response, all tactics that have been proven to work. Second, backlash to surveillance programs undermines counterterror cooperation. As we mentioned earlier, metadata collection risks foreign relations crucial for counterterrorism efforts. Two reports by two separate executive branch panels noted that most terrorist plots that have been disrupted since 9/11 have relied on legal surveillance drones overseas and then shared with the US. If domestic surveillance programs cause data localization and reverse global information sharing, that will have a big impact on our ability to reduce terror attacks. The threat of terrorism, rather than being an argument in favor of bulk data collection, is actually a reason to abandon it as a failed strategy in favor of more effective, targeted approaches. Our opponents have accused us of not understanding that there needs to be balance between privacy and security. Of course, we agree with that. The difference is that we believe that alternatives to metadata collection, targeted, court-sanctioned surveillance, are better strategies to address security concerns. We also believe that our opponents have tipped the balance too far towards the security threat. No doubt, terrorism ought to be prevented, but if metadata makes counterterrorism 0.001% more effective, possibly even less effective, that is not a reason to abandon crucial constitutional tenets and risk foreign relations. Thank you.
I'd like to talk about your point on data overload. I realize that to everyone in this room, coming through millions of bits of data sounds daunting. However, data analysis is constantly improving. Data scientists devote their lives to developing learning algorithms that computers can use to sort through data more and more efficiently. Why would we stop that process just as it is being developed? Just because it's not perfect yet?
As I stated before, even the most technologically advanced algorithms would flag tens of thousands of false positives that distract from tracking down actual threats. And the technology we have now isn't even that precise. So as we wait for the process to improve, many terrorist threats that could go undetected in the interim that would otherwise be avoidable. We don't think the process of counterterrorism should stop just because it's not perfect, but rather that relying on targeted methods is more dependable than indiscriminate surveillance.
How do those targeted methods work without metadata networks underlying their targeting process?
Empirics have proven that targeted surveillance has been reliable time and time and again, where metadata has failed. In the instance of the Boston bombing, as I mentioned before, all necessary information was gathered using targeted methods, which proves that bulk data isn't necessary and only serves to distract from actual threats.
For minor attacks, thank you. You mentioned that metadata collection might hurt foreign relations. However, relations with our joint surveillance allies, the Five Eyes Alliance, are stronger than ever. Why would domestic surveillance meaningfully hurt foreign relations in the future if it hasn't in the past 16 years?
Well, first of all, I disagree that our alliances are stronger than ever. In fact, the Snowden link, which we mentioned before, seriously imperiled our foreign relations, and our evidence says data localization is already beginning because of mass surveillance, and that continued bulk collection undermines broader areas of cooperation between the US and its allies.
But the Snowden leak harmed foreign relations because it revealed targeted surveillance of Angela Merkel. Why does bulk data collection hurt foreign relations?
I disagree, because the Snowden leaks exposed our mass surveillance apparatus, which we have evidence on that says other countries are alienated by that apparatus, not just the targeted spying. It's also the continuation and expansion of that program that's alienating our allies and deterring information sharing that's actually more effective in countering terrorism than our surveillance apparatus.
Okay, thank you. I have one more question. You claim targeted surveillance can work just as well as bulk data collection, but I want to dig into this. Can you outline exactly like what the FBI does to decide who to get a warrant on when doing targeted surveillance?
Well,
how does that work?
So there can be things like that went in our evidence, human intelligence, law enforcement cooperation, community tip-offs, those all can result, those can all be evidence for getting a warrant and then doing that electronic surveillance that you say is key. It's just a question of, like, I'm not sure if that answers your question.
It does, thank you.
The 9/11 attacks. NSA experts believe that the largest attack on US soil could have been prevented with metadata collection and analysis. Our opponents have repeatedly stated that not a single attack has been prevented with metadata collection, but what about learning from our mistakes to prevent future attacks? The NSA and the FBI believe that if they had more rigorous surveillance in place before the attacks, it would have revealed that the hijackers were already in the United States and thus much more threatening. This was a crucial information gap that existed before 9/11, and it's part of the reason that metadata examination was created in the first place. Our opponents are very concerned about the risk of information overload. Even if we agree that there are a number of false positives, every year, we have three responses to this. First is that the number of false positives will decline over time. Each year, advances in technology make metadata more effective and targeted. Already, since many of their statistics were published, the analysis methods have greatly improved. Second, the concern about false positives ought to be much less concerning than the threat that we missed the needle in the haystack. Following dead ends is an inevitable part of combating terrorism, and the false positives and some wasted time should not be a reason to abandon such a strategy. Third, and most importantly, metadata enables the NSA and FBI to more effectively evaluate threats. It is a significant enabler for analysis and allows intelligence agencies to prioritize different threats. Shea continues that without ability to obtain metadata, NSA would lose a tool for detecting communication chains, which can lead to identification of previously unknown persons of interest. Bulk metadata allows analysis of communication in an efficient manner. Any other means that might be used to attempt to conduct similar analyses would require multiple time-consuming steps that would frustrate needed rapid analysis in emergent situations and could fail to capture data available through metadata. Now, as you can see, NSA officials believe that metadata is the most efficient mechanism to synthesize data about terrorist organizations and saves the FBI time when tracking down potential threats. Rather than create information overload, metadata would provide important contextual information that the FBI can then use to make their searches more targeted. Our opponents have argued that there are more targeted surveillance options available. However, Shea explains further that although the NSA protects a number of sources of information that can be used to separate and independent indications of potential terrorist activity, the best analysis occurs when NSA intelligence analysts can consider information from all of those sources together to compile as complete a picture as possible. While metadata is not the sole source of information, it provides a component of the information analysts rely upon to execute threat identification. The last topic raised by our opponents is that of foreign relations and data localization. I would like to take a moment to address these concerns that they brought up. It's important to remember that the strategy that the affirmative is employing is to cease bulk data collection. They don't end all US surveillance. They don't end spying on US allies, and they don't end a myriad of other questionable policies that endanger cooperation. It's more likely that the Snowden leak, information that we directly spied on European allies, is what caused data localization rather than the bulk data collection that they are discussing. Even our opponents say that the Snowden leaks are what caused our European allies to be more tentative. It's also important to remember that European cooperation is largely inevitable, even if they are less thrilled with US surveillance tactics. Mutual interest is the driving force behind cooperation over terrorism, and they have the same incentives as the United States to stop terrorism. With that being said, we don't think that foreign relations is enough of a reason to increase the risk of terrorist attacks. Thank you, I'm open for cross-examination.
that metadata collection could have stopped 9/11? This seems like some serious Monday morning quarterbacking. There are, I'm sure, hundreds of small things we could have done in hindsight to prevent 9/11, but if metadata is so crucial now, why did congressional studies find no evidence linking preventions of a terror attack with bulk data analysis?
Now, as previously mentioned, the NSA classifies a lot of those reports so that rogue actors don't get a hold of national security tactics. We don't want information to get into the wrong hands. Now, it's not just the NSA that is saying that bulk data is an efficient manner. This is an intelligence community consensus. And because of internal politics between the FBI, NSA, CIA, etc., having them agree on something is actually remarkable.
You make the argument that bulk surveillance gives analysts a full picture of possible terrorist activity. Why does this surveillance have to be carried out indiscriminately rather than by getting a warrant?
It's about laying the groundwork and understanding the different mechanisms and the different webs of communication that indicate that terrorist activity is occurring.
Your evidentiary support for the importance of bulk data to counter-terror efforts comes from NSA's Director of Signals Intelligence. Why should we accept the word of someone who has a monetary incentive to hype up the effectiveness of NSA programs?
I don't think getting a security clearance is the same thing as having a monetary incentive. And like I said earlier, this is an intelligence community consensus that is agreeing upon the importance of bulk data collection.
You say that the Snowden leak primarily motivated other countries to localize their data, but the content of those leaks detailed metadata collection. Why doesn't this prove that bulk surveillance alienated our allies?
I would say that it's because correlation does not mean causation. Because the report had bulk data collection and spying on allies does not mean that bulk data collection is spying on US allies.
Thank you.
Remember, I said that we would have a chance for some audience questions, so we've entered the opportunity for audience cross-examination. Warren and Lena are going to be working on their closing statements, but we will take some questions from the audience. Yeah.
So, aren't you allowed to ask each side?
Just, they're going to kind of all answer together, and so just go ahead and ask your question.
Okay. I was going to ask about the, I guess the question is how does the Patriot Act act, like how can you verify factually that it stopped massive terror attacks, let's say the size of 9/11, since that period of time? Because it seems that there's a general trend of terror attacks actually just going down. So I wanted to ask that question.
Okay, so the question is how can you prove that the Patriot Act has been successful in stopping terrorist attacks?
Yes.
We have a lot of evidence from the FBI. The intelligence community has said that this is the most important tool that they have to fight terrorism, not only at home, but abroad. But there's also the point that the existence of this bulk data collection is enough to deter terrorists from attacking the United States because of the mass network of surveillance.
Follow?
Sure, go ahead.
Oh, and I'll follow. How can you necessarily trust these intelligence agencies if they've made massive flukes in the past? I mean, I understand that they may have agreed on this, but most of these intelligence agencies also agreed that WMDs are in Iraq, and as we saw, that was quite wrong.
Every agency is going to make mistakes from here and there, but the existence of this surveillance and its necessity to fight terrorism is still one of the best things that they could possibly have.
Yeah, skepticism of government agencies is natural, especially highly classified government agencies. However, in the case of bulk data collection, the fact that we haven't seen a major terrorist attack since 9/11 is pretty indicative of the fact that it works.
Let's go somewhere else and then
You guys mentioned in your opening speech that terrorism is currently on the rise, while your opponents mentioned that metadata has reportedly never stopped the terrorist attack. And since anything saying it would just be mere speculation on your part, how can you say that metadata is effective when you yourself said that terrorism is increasing?
It's important to note that this discussion is about domestic surveillance, and while global terrorism is still a major security issue for the United States, the issue of domestic terrorism is nowhere near the threat it was 16 years ago.
Would you say that whether or not government surveillance changes individuals' behavior and their use of social media, their phone calls, all of that, whether or not it changes that, is it ethically acceptable to give people a choice between owning a smartphone, having social media, and having the government collect their
Yes, well, I think that because of the, I think that that's a choice that we as a society are currently, we right now are faced with the decision because all of our data is out there. And we know that they are tracking our metadata. We know that they're looking at our Facebook. We know that for a fact. And I think that that's a choice the American people shouldn't have to make. Social media in and of itself is necessary in a 21st century economy. And we certainly want the government to be, to force us to feel information that we otherwise wouldn't have, because we are going to have to put some feeling information online, or if we might not have to, but a lot of us will be doing it through the necessary social.
I think we're going to, the other side wants to jump in here with the response.
I argue that the government not owning your data right now, that's an illusion. Your social security number has basically everything about you already attached to it, and the government already has all of that information for reasons that we find totally acceptable, like getting a job, ensuring immigration status, etc. So I think that while there is obviously a question of ethics in terms of like social media data gathering, I think that it's wrong to say that like we haven't already breached the subject.
I have just a quick clarification question about data localization. I'm not really sure what it is or how it works. The countries just stopped sharing their internet with the United States as a result of bulk data collection.
It's basically mass protectionism of data within a country, right? So you have a country and people in the country share data and stuff on social media. And what ends up happening is that countries begin to sort of create a divide between their data and the data that we can access. And so what the implications for this
I guess, what are your thoughts on the possibility that bulk data collection could influence terrorists to find other ways of communicating or carrying out act of terrorism, and then it's not helping prevention anymore, but just harming the privacy of innocent citizens in the United States, knowing about any terrorist acts?
I think that's a reason as to why we should make the technology more improved and more targeted, rather than scrapping it altogether and going back to square one.
Right, and the existence of security clearances ensures that terrorists only know that, like, we can spy on the internet, but they don't have the specific mechanisms that we use to do that. So I don't think it pushes them deep enough underground that we can't still track them.
I just wanted to say that that is a very real concern, considering how encryption technology does keep improving. And this technology, while the public, while the average American, while you, while neither you nor I has really any access to it, terrorists probably can find new ways to encrypt their data. So it's likely that the encryption technology, I mean, is advancing at a really rapid rate. I mean, just look at the progress of, Tor, and how we have a deep, I would say that this is a very good answer.
Okay, we'll do one more in the back, and then we'll wrap up with the rebuttals. Yeah.
So in a society that we're in today where minority groups across the country are worried about their status as citizens or of their safety in various groups and situations, including from governmental agencies, who is to keep those in the running with the Patriot Act? Who's to keep them in check? Who's to keep them from using that information that they can gather from an individual's social media accounts and other such devices for ulterior purposes?
That's a valid concern. However, the issue of bulk data is solely about phone calls and how long you've been on the phone with a different phone number. So it's about tracking people who we identify as terrorists. And also that only the NSA or other intelligence agencies have the authority to use that. So it is normally excluded from direct political motives.
Okay, we're gonna have to wrap it up and then we'll head into the rebuttals. And so Lena is gonna give her concluding remarks, then Lauren is gonna give her concluding remarks, and then I'll wrap it up.
Privacy and foreign relations are not issues to be taken lightly. Constitutional protections are the foundation of American democracy. Creating security exceptions to the Constitution is a dangerous, slippery slope. Even if there are other concerns that foreign allies have, we should not continue to play with fire and risk ending cooperation because of metadata collection, especially when there are viable, legally sound alternatives. We believe that even if you grant the premise of our opponent's arguments, or of our opponent's premise that terrorism is an increasing threat that takes precedent over privacy concerns, you should still abandon bulk data collection. Metadata analysis causes information overload. The constant need to track down false positives drains resources that would be better spent on tactics that are empirically successful. Our opponents cling to the argument that 9/11 could have been prevented with bulk intelligence. However, this confuses correlation with causation and isn't backed up by any evidence. Just because a terrorist attack happened while we didn't have mass surveillance doesn't mean having mass surveillance would have stopped it. Even the evidence read by the negative from James Lewis says that bulk collection is the least useful program available to the intelligence community. Our opponents ask us to learn from our mistakes, but fail to recognize that each day bulk surveillance continues, imperfect technology makes thousands of mistakes that actively impede the NSA's ability to target serious threats. Our evidence comes from a computing and technology expert, indicates that even if our opponents are correct, that technological advances will happen in the future, even the most advanced algorithms will flag so many false positives that finding the needle in the haystack will become impossible. Our opponents ask us to trust in those who have security clearance, but remember that actual NSA analysts have described sifting through data as trying to drink from a fire hose. If that isn't close enough to a relevant source, I don't know what is. Our opponents claim bulk data is necessary to give analysts a full picture of potential threats, but this should not be a reason to maintain it, especially because alternatives are much more reliable. For example, human intelligence, law enforcement cooperation, and community tip-offs. Officials were able to gather information on the Boston bombers before the attack, which proves that targeted methods can be just as effective. Unfortunately, these leads were never investigated because too many resources were wasted on chasing down false positives. In addition to being a counterproductive counterterrorism strategy, bulk data collection is a violation of core constitutional tenets and risks foreign relations through data localization. That is why we believe the federal government ought to cease bulk data collection. Thank you. terrorism is, at worst, increasing and at best, still present. The affirmative team would use this opportunity to end one of the vital counterterrorism methods, bulk data collection. Even if the system is imperfect, it would be an ill-advised time to limit the choices we have for combating terrorism. I'd like to start by addressing my opponent's privacy concerns. While the right to privacy is an important aspect of our democracy, it's not an absolute right. Concerns about privacy need to be balanced against the threat of terrorism, just as the right to bear arms has historically been balanced against public safety concerns. Additionally, you should take my opponent's privacy concerns with a grain of salt. I'd like to reiterate Shannon McDonough's research, which indicates that the vast majority of privacy invasion claims were unsubstantiated. They were motivated by an instinctual fear of Big Brother, not by any actual violations. The threat of terrorism is too great to be swept under the rug by uncertain claims of privacy invasion. Now, metadata is a critical tool in our counterterror tool belt. This is not my opinion, but the opinion of the NSA's Director of Signals Intelligence and other officials who have the clearance to actually know what stops major terror attacks. The fact that there has not been a major terror attack on US soil since 9/11 is proof of their claim. Their Boston bombing example is actually just proof that metadata prevents major terror attacks. While the attack in Boston was tragic, it was small. The existence of the NSA's metadata program has either stopped or deterred large-scale attacks. Additionally, targeted surveillance cannot function without metadata. Bulk surveillance discovers patterns of suspicious communication that intelligence officials use to decide who to target. Without bulk surveillance, we're requesting warrants almost at random and just hoping that we find a terrorist. Now, my opponent's concerns about information overload are well-intentioned, but ultimately unfounded for a few reasons. First, rapid advances in technology ensure that analysis is always getting better. Sorting algorithms improve, technological capacity increases, and the number of false positives declines over time. We should not abandon a promising and critical counterterror strategy just because it's not perfect right now. Second, dead ends are an inevitable part of counterterror. No method of surveillance is 100% exact, but the positives of bulk data clearly outweigh the negatives, as I have demonstrated. Third, metadata is a significant enabler of threat prioritization, as I previously explained. Metadata collection provides the contextual information that allows for effective targeted surveillance. Now, when considering my opponent's concern about foreign relations, it's important to note that their position of ending bulk data collection isn't a magic bullet. They don't end all US surveillance, and they don't end spying on US allies. Remember, the Angela Merkel scandal, which is the only surveillance-related foreign relations scandal, was caused by targeted surveillance of a foreign ally. They also don't end other questionable policies that endanger cooperation. It's also important to take a step back and look at the current status of foreign relations. Counterterror cooperation with our European allies is still strong after 16 years of metadata collection. This is indicative of the fact that US-European cooperation is largely inevitable because of mutual interest. Today we urge you to learn from past mistakes. Intelligence gaps leading to 9/11 made a preventable attack possible. We believe that continuing metadata is crucial to fill those gaps. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much. Could we get another round of applause for all of us? Give you all an opportunity to reflect on some things that you thought over the last 16 years, some things that you may or may not have known about our policies in response to counterterrorism, and we think it's really important to stay engaged about questions like executive authority, counterterrorism efforts, obviously bulk data collection, and we think that there are issues that affect everybody really 16 years on from 9/11. I want to wrap up with just a couple of thank yous. Thank you to the MSU Alumni Association for helping us live stream the debate. I know we have a few debate alums on there. They've been texting me, excited to watch our students debate tonight. So it's a really great opportunity for us. And thank you to the Honors College for their help coordinating the event and making sure that it was a success and for including us in the celebration of the 60th anniversary. We've really enjoyed preparing for the debate and having the opportunity to showcase some of our students tonight.
The MSU Union did a great job in helping us find a space that fit well for it. And I just want to thank the students who participated today. They worked really hard to research the topic. It goes above and beyond what we asked them to do on the debate team. And they really thought it was important to give well-informed, well-researched arguments for you all today. And so I really appreciate it. And thank you to all of you who took the time tonight on your Monday night to come here with us. We really appreciate it. And hopefully we'll see you all at some future public debates as well. So thank you.